This week on Maker Update, an update for CircuitPython, Adafruit IO Plus, casting metal in kinetic sand, a 3D printed tape measure tool, reusing vintage voltmeters, and hacking with SLA batteries. It's Wednesday, I'm Donald Bell, and welcome to another Maker Update. I hope you're all doing well. It was a beautiful day at East Bay Mini Maker Faire this past Sunday. I saw lots of friends, met some new people, and was inspired by a lot of great projects. And I'm telling you, if you ever need a reminder that humanity might not be completely doomed, go to a Maker Faire. I don't have a lot of projects to share with you this week, but I do have lots of tips and some news to share, so let's get right into it. First up, some news. Adafruit's CircuitPython API has been updated to version 2.1. If you're unfamiliar, this is a bare-bones version of the Python programming language that's compatible with a growing range of project boards made by Adafruit. The update can be downloaded from GitHub. There are a number of bug fixes and updates, including a new Pulse IO protocol that allows you to send or receive pulse width modulation signals over a digital pin. The big upshot of that is the ability to work with servos, but also helps with some LEDs and for buzzing piezo speakers and other stuff. Adafruit also announced an update to their IoT cloud platform, Adafruit IO. In addition to the existing free plan, users can now subscribe for $10 a month to open up unlimited feeds and dashboards and 2 months of data storage. If you're hot on making IoT projects, it's a solid-looking and fiercely open platform. Lots of tips to share this week. On Gareth Branwyn's Tips of the Week column on Makezine, there's this cool idea for quick casting metal using kinetic sand and a tin alloy. A video from Homemade Modern shows how to make a quick mold from kinetic sand and then casting a low melting point metal. The result looks great and doesn't damage the sand. On Instructables, mikeasaurus shares this file for a 3D printed pencil holder add-on for a tape measure, allowing you to quickly mark your measurements. The printed part just fits right into the belt clip of your tape measure, which makes it pretty universal. A friend of mine introduced me to a YouTube channel that was new to me called the Post-Apocalyptic Inventor. He has a great and thorough guide on reusing and modifying old moving coil voltmeters. He also has a great one on reusing motors from old washing machines. Maker extraordinaire Becky Stern has a useful, no-nonsense instructable on best practices for splicing wires. I can't tell you how many projects I've done with bad or even dangerous splices. Hopefully this guide will spare you some of the trial and error of learning safe splicing technique. And for a quick project I brought to East Bay Maker Faire last weekend, I loaded up a Raspberry Pi with the Museum MP4 software to play a loop of videos on a tiny portable cathode ray TV. I mentioned this software a long time ago in a previous Maker update, but this was my first time using it, and it was dead simple. Two things I realized while actually using it. One, the software setup is read-only, so there's no danger in corrupting the SD card just by switching the power off. Two, they've recently added the ability to connect a simple switch or button across two of the I/O pins on the Raspberry Pi so that you can skip videos. Aside from that, everything is deliberately kept super simple, making it great for kiosks and installations and even mobile things like what I did. Which brings us to my tool of the week. Sealed lead acid batteries. In this cool tools review, I'm going to show you why it's useful to have a 12-volt SLA battery around. I got this one for about $20 on Amazon, and if you want to get this exact same one, you can use the Amazon link in the description, which also helps support my videos and the Cool Tools blog. The first time I encountered a sealed lead acid battery was in a Power Wheels kids ride-on car. Instead of having something like this take 100 D-cell batteries that have to be thrown away, the manufacturer mercifully includes a dedicated battery that can be recharged over and over again. Like your basic car battery, these are an old-school rechargeable technology. They're sealed up completely, so there's no major risk of spilling or chemical exposure unless you really work to crack these open. The major downside to these is that they're heavy. Compared to the LiPo and lithium-ion packs in most of our gadgets, these things weigh a ton. But they come in a range of shapes and sizes and a more standard range of voltages. You do need to exercise some caution not to bridge the terminals accidentally, or they could spark, just like any battery. I'll often store these with gaffer tape across them as insulation. They're very simple to recharge. I have this $17 Battery Buddy charger that I can just clip on and plug in, and it charges automatically. Fancier RC battery chargers will typically have a setting for SLA2. Now here's why I consider these a tool. I have used these multiple times to make plug-in 12-volt appliances portable. If you have a thing that you typically plug in using an AC adapter, that adapter is often doing the work to translate 110-volt AC into 9 or 12 volts DC. It will usually say right on the adapter. So for example, my family has this air mattress that we use for camping, and it came with a 12-volt inflator that works off an AC adapter or a car cigarette lighter adapter. But because I like inflating the bed in the tent, I just wired this up to use the 12-volt battery by exposing the wires and putting crimp connectors on it. Problem solved. As another example, I had this portable cathode ray TV that took 8 C-cell batteries or a 12-volt AC adapter. So I just wired a barrel jack cable with crimp spade connectors and glued the battery to the bottom of the TV along with a Raspberry Pi that autoplays videos. It's a little chunky, but it's portable and rechargeable. So that's a look at SLA batteries. They're heavy, but they're cheap, durable, rechargeable, and easy to hack for stuff that runs on 12 volts DC. You can pick one up using the link in the description, and you can see thousands of reader recommended tools like this at cool-tools.org. Maker Faires is another big weekend for fairs. We've got Istanbul, Turkey, Pueblo, Colorado, Bilbao, Spain, Montevideo, Uruguay, Calgary in Alberta, Canada, Derby in Derbyshire, UK, Dresden, Germany, and Wichita Falls, Texas. If one of those is near you, get out there. But if the one near you stinks, go to Derby and say hi to my friend Dominic. And that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave me a thumbs up, leave me a comment, sign up on the email list for extra stuff, and have a great Halloween. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next week.